Okay, I think we should get started then. I am very pleased to be introducing Dalia Malki. She is the CTO of DM Association, the lead maintainer of the DM project, lead researcher at Novi, and also a longstanding member of the DISC community. She has a long resume, both in academia and in industry. First as a professor at Hebrew University, principal researcher at Microsoft Research Silicon Valley, co-founder, principal research at VMware Research, and now at DM. She's one of the unique individuals in our community, I think, who both deeply understands the fundamental algorithmic issues, and at the same time knows how to translate those issues, translate those ideas into practical real-world systems that can have sort of huge impact. So I'm therefore very excited to hear her perspective today on tech transfer and how research projects can have real world impact. So Dalia, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Seth, and thanks for inviting me. And as I was preparing the topic for this talk, I thought, oh my God, did I really get this all that I've reached the point when I can tell stories. But I actually thought that this is really sort of the best content that I can bring to this audience, given what I've been doing the past couple of years. The stories all revolve around, you know, principles of distributed computing that are very, very much at the foundations of this community. But I think they could be of interest to anyone. So I spent the past two decades as an industrial researcher in various labs in the Silicon Valley, and this was by choice. I started my career as an academic professor and then joined in 2004, the back then Microsoft Research Lab in the Silicon Valley. I later became a founding member of the research group at VMware and more recently joined the DM project. And I'll talk about projects from all three epochs in my career. I was fortunate to be involved in projects that really had innovative and cutting edge aspects to them. And at the same time, I was involved in bringing them to production and execution. And I thought I'd share some insights from this process, this flywheel of synergy and interaction between research, academia, and innovation in industrial settings. So I'm going to try to squeeze four stories in 1 hour. Let's see if it works. And I gave them the following titles. One will be too much abstraction. The second one will be too little abstraction. The third one, value of unlearning. And the fourth one, developer first. But let me first talk about the high level kind of wisdom I can extract from these two decades of working alongside production and development. And this is what I will refer to as the research product flywheel. And I'll start with a quote by Leslie Lamport, who is not only the founder of the foundations that underlie all of the stories that I will talk about, and obviously a pioneer in distributed computing, but he was also somebody who spent his career at industrial research labs. And he said, if I, Leslie, work by myself and come up with problems, I'd come up with only a small number of things. But if I go out to the world where people are working on real computer systems, there are a million problems out there. When I look back at most of the things I, Leslie Lamport, worked on, Byzantine Generals, Paxos, and so on, they come from real world problems. And this has been my North Star and this guidance and insight that Leslie gave us, the researchers at Microsoft. This has been my North Star throughout my career. And indeed, my experience, my two cents is that when this kind of tech transfer between researchers and production works, it's extremely powerful. And if I have to try to characterize it, the one takeaway I want you to take from, this notion of a flywheel is that the very notion of tech transfer seems to indicate that one-way transfer, a researcher comes to developers throws a white paper at them and say, hey, build. That's not the way it works. In fact, tech transfer has to be a two-way stream. And what I found is that there has to be these facilitators and champions on both sides in order for this to work. And I'll say this in the most positive way, no judgment, but there really needs to be a researcher on the research side that looks at the hundreds and thousands of extremely interesting and extremely important innovation that takes a lot of technical depth and is really important to do. But look at all of this and say, which one and what actually solves a problem for us right now? Not downgrading all of the 4,000 papers out there in the same field. They're all important. That's the only way we can advance the art. It needs to happen. But what actually solves the problem? And skill and that ability and that willingness to do that is the facilitator on the research side. At the same time, there needs to be a champion on the product side. And again, I say this without judgment. On the production side, engineers are tied to a roadmap and timeline, and inherent caution and conservatism that comes from the fact that they are the ones that will be paged in the middle of the night when something breaks. They can't just do something because it's cool. They really, really need to be accountable for this. But at the same time, to have somebody who can champion new ideas and pivots and open to innovation without necessarily getting a career reward for that right away is a unique skill, unique talent, and is necessary in order to facilitate. And again, when this happens, what I found is it's remarkably powerful. So when production teams want to work with researchers, they present with challenges and problems that are really compelling. It makes research better. It makes research relevant. It brings up questions that are real and are grounded and motivated and are hard to come up by alone. And then when research provides, those innovative, new, differentiating factor techniques and added value, then it makes the product unique. And then again, there are unique challenges that only that group works on and vice versa. So it's extremely powerful and extremely empowering. So here I'll go and talk about several of these activities that I was fortunate to participate in. All of them revolve around this very core notion of state machine replication, which I was exposed to early on as a student already. And I thought it was remarkable. You can really state the abstraction in one sentence that everybody understands. You want to construct a service which externally to clients provides exactly the semantics, the appearance, the behavior of a single service. So it's very well defined and understood what the service does, as if it was, just a single sequential service. But internally, it can mask the failure or the unavailability or any kind of flaw in any individual component. But the group as a whole continues maintaining the service. So here's a really succinct problem definition. You can say it in one sentence. And there were solutions to it already when I was a student. So it seems like last word, right? Everything's done. There's a problem, there's a solution, done. As we know, thousands of papers have been written about it. And I want to talk about some directions in which real world systems and projects took in just this very specific domain of state machine replication. But again, I hope that the stories would be relevant and of interest, no matter which field you're in. I'll start with too much abstraction. So at a very high level, the pioneering solution to state machine replication have reduced the problem to its core. And this is what we do as mathematicians, and this is, extremely elegant and compelling. So it is to say you want to replicate a service. You construct the service as a state machine that processes a sequence of commands. All you need to do is form agreement on the sequence of commands and let all the replicas process it. In order to form agreement on a sequence of commands, what do you need to do? You need to solve this agreement problem once and then repeat it. And this is great as an abstraction, as a mathematical reduction. And indeed, you can solve consensus once and then repeat it again and again. And you've got a mathematical solution. There are a few problems with this abstraction. And I already said, I labeled this story as too much abstraction. So the first problem is, if you really solve independently each one of these agreement problems alone, you might end up with agreeing on what happens at command number a million before you've even started the sequence. And what do you know what the service state will be at command number a million? But the mathematical abstraction allows it. And this is not just a theoretical statement. Actual implementations that tried to bring state machine replication solutions by solving it one at a time encountered this problem that occasionally there would be a hole and agreement was formed on later commands without actually completing the agreement on earlier ones. And then you have a sequence with holes, and it's not clear what the state machines should do with these holes. Should they wait? Should they process? What state will they fill in? Developers were really, really having a hard time with building any kind of service on top of an abstraction and on top of a service that's constructed this way. The problem is even more exacerbated when the leader that proposed the sequence and left some holes is replaced. And then a new leader comes and says, oh, okay, then I can fill the holes. However, these holes were originally part of a sequence that a succession that was proposed by the first leader, and they had some kind of a semantics, and the first leader intended for them to be executed one after another. And now just filling them with any command, just waiting until they're filled and processing them violates that intention, that high level intention. And again, developers that we talked to were really grappling with this problem. So what happened in practice was that all practical systems, early systems that employed state machine replications really formed decisions sequentially one at a time. They waited for one decision to be completely executed before they even started the second one because of this over obstruction. Now, to make things even worse, a lot of these state machines are used as control planes that actually have control commands that determine the configuration of the state machine itself. So the control command itself, the command itself in the sequence can change what the service itself is doing. And so now when you embed these control commands in the sequence these are the holes, then you really don't know what is the state of the service itself when forming later decisions before the control commands are executed. So this abstraction completely breaks when you allow the service to the state machine now replication to reconfigure itself. It's really not one at a time. You really have to first execute and form agreement on an entire prefix before you know how to even form agreement on the next one. And the last, the fourth and last problem with this over abstraction is that we're actually conflicting two completely different problems. So the problem of replication on the one hand needs to solve durability, needs to guarantee that there are enough copies of the service in case of a failure to store the state and serve clients. But the other thing that state machine replication needs to solve is to deal with failures when they happen and reconfigure the cluster itself and the replication engine itself. But these are two problems that have completely different requirements. The first problem, the problem of durability, nobody would put two F plus one replicas to make sure that you can always make progress as you would need for agreement. The first problem, the entire industry will just deploy two servers, two copies to tolerate one failure, or three copies to tolerate two failures. They would never deploy more than that because, you know, this could be a sizable state and heavy servers. The second problem, the problem of control and of responding to failures and masking them, those, you know, we know that you need actually two F plus one copies to tolerate F. But with state machine replication obstruction, and just looking at this as a sequence of agreements, you conflate these two. So for over a decade working with various groups, this over-obstruction has surfaced. And this has been noticed by the zookeeper engineers at Yahoo, and it has been noticed by the Stanford Raft team. And working with colleagues at Cornell, we talked about virtual synchrony and the foundations of that. And finally, with Lampert, we published a small note called Vertical Praxis that really gave a slightly more formal foundation to take away, to remove the over-obstruction and really look at the sequence of agreement decisions as a growing log where the log itself can be replicated with the minimal amount of replication needed for durability. So F plus one is needed to tolerate F failures. And then if there's a failure, then you need to, first of all, make sure that you disable the current service with an operation that we call seal, and then start a new service, which also has the minimal amount of durability needed. And then if that service has a failure, then again, you need to seal it to guarantee that, you know, it cannot continue operating with a seal command and bring up another service. And there's a separate control plane that forms agreement on what the current view is. And that itself can be replicated and uses consensus to decide and manage the sealing and the handover to the next view. So this is a very, you know, a fairly simple, straightforward foundation that we call the Vertical Paxos. And the takeaway, the flywheel takeaway is, you know, this was retrofitting the algorithmic foundations to what the engineering world has already been deploying. Like I said, nobody in, you know, the large infrastructure companies would ever deploy five servers, five replicas of, you know, gigabytes or exabytes of data in order to tolerate two failures. They would deploy three. But they did not have the algorithmic foundations, and the community has been able to, you know, provide these foundations. And now I think engineers have the foundations and much more confidence, and they already talk when they build systems about building the systems with vertical taxes. So takeaway, sometimes being a mathematician is over-abstracting. On the other hand, sometimes it's too little abstraction. So let me move to the second story. And this is the story that actually starts at Microsoft when Phil Bernstein had this insight that the way databases were built in the past were really optimized for working with a disk and much, much smaller memories. But a couple of things have happened in technology over the years that made that trade-off much, much less obvious. One is memories have become far, far closer in their size to disks. So it used to be that memories were really kilobytes or megabytes and disks could store gigabytes. But then memories became cheaper and you now have, you know, I have on my laptop right now close to 100 gig real memory. That was one thing. The other thing that happened is, of course, solid state drives or SSDs, which made you know, non-volatile memory much, much faster, and the trade-offs of using it very different from a spinning disk. So he had this insight that you could actually build databases that store only the log, the commit log on disk, and everything else is materialized in memory. Memory is all of the index and all of the search data structures can be stored in memory. So you have this insight, this was back in around 2012, and he built the in-memory database foundations in a system that was later incorporated in Microsoft's a cloud database, the SQL Azure. But what he needed is a way to construct a very, very performant in terms of capacity and throughput log using clusters of SSDs. He came to me and others at the Microsoft Lab for help. And what we've realized is that here, really, when you think about state machine replication as just one group that replicates everything, you're really under-abstracting. And you could take the same principles and apply it by striping the log, which gives the same abstraction as a single state machine replication, but under the hood is really composed of many stripes, and this is still state machine replication. So it looks like state machine replication. It is striped over groups and groups and groups over a cluster, so that you can get essentially unlimited scale out. And while it looks like state machine replication, it is also fundamentally different, and the devil is in the detail. What I'm trying to capture in this graphic here is that while it looks like state machine replication, the important detail is that you don't want to have any contention when you're striping over a log. You don't want everybody to compete for one stripe and then one wins and then move to the next stripe and then everybody competes and move to the next stripe. What you really want is in the steady state to have no contention, to really stripe very efficiently and move across the cluster. And so while a leader in normal state replication can handle contention, we didn't want any contention. And what we've constructed is this abstraction of a sequencer, which is memoryless, it's stateless, it's just a counter. And it serves as a orchestrator over a cluster that lets clients that want to append to the log get a ticket, go to the right stripe without contention, and write to that stripe. And so in a normal case, everything is already ordered by going to the sequencer, but the sequencer is not storing anything. It's not processing anything. It doesn't do any IO. It's just a ticket manager. And then you have consensus to begin with when you get to actually replicate and persist a state. The cluster is able to handle contention, but for high throughput, you never have contention. So we built this in a system called Corfu, which is a high throughput distributed log, which is striped over a cluster. Externally, it provides just the abstraction of the log, SMR is really both under and over Corfu. So, and the one, the single log is really replicated over an entire cluster built on over many, many state machines. As I said, this started in 2012. Some of you may remember 2014, Microsoft shut down the lab. CorfuDB stayed there and ended up being part of the infrastructure that underlies SQL and Azure. And, it became this state machine replication over multiple logs. But a bunch of us founded VMware. And what we found is that the way services are managed over cloud clusters is they're actually composed not just like the Corfu log is over uniform, you know, many, many instances of state machines that are uniform and built by us, but actually a typical cluster that supports, you know, any stream of whether it's web clicks or user reviews or monitoring data or logging. Any cluster in the cloud today in a deployed service gets this initial stream, which is essentially stored and logged in sequence. But then the same stream is taken out and processed by data analytics, scaling and elasticity management, by load balancing, deploying it to multiple services. Then you need distributed transactions over all of these services. So you have a log manager like Chubby or like Zookeeper, and then you have a distributed transaction engine that starts by ordering and then deploying it. So there were typically, you know, in a cluster of a deployed system, there were dozens of these state machine components, very similar to the Corfu log, but not built by the same team. And all of them were essentially using the same information, the same source, ground source of truth, which was the log. And so what we've built and continued building was the Corfu DB project, which essentially takes the log stored and used for high throughput and durability and build multiple services, multiple materialized views over the same log. All of them are state machine replication, but they're using it for completely different purposes. And this, you know, this way to take the same feed of network events or metering or logging data and use it for many, many, many purposes is what now underlies and drives the software-defined networking product at VMware NSX. And it was also later used in Facebook recently, two papers in the coming SOSPI paper and previously in OSDI. I believe based paper, a system called Delos essentially takes legacy replication systems, you know, ZPDB, RocksDB, this, that, they're all essentially about Zookeeper, they're all essentially doing the same thing. They're replicating using state machine replication. And what Delos does is allows to, in production, live without bringing any service down, replace any state machine replication service with another, with a better one, by giving the right abstractions on top of it. And then also giving any service that uses essentially replicated sequence data, giving the right abstractions to materialize views that use fundamentally the log as the commit basis for transactions in multiple services. And this is the topic of the coming SOSPI paper. Third story. So while doing some of this work on Corfu DB and various projects in the industry that derived from it, we had a summer intern, Heidi Howard, that arrived and looked at Corfu. And I kind of asked her to look at how to formalize the performance of you know, state machine replication, given the fact that you know, we really have all these paradigms. And what she did instead is she observed a really, really surprising observation and said, well, you know, fundamentally, state machine replication ever since its inception was based on the principle of quorums. So we talked about durability has you know, needs only F plus one, changing the leader needs two F plus one, but fundamentally this notion of majority quorums is at the basis, is at the foundations of all of these replication systems. And what she's observed is, look at Corfu. You have a sequencer and you have you know, many, many shards, and the sequencer is working with these shards, and these shards are not intersecting with one another at all. And there are no majorities. And in fact, looking back at the foundations of Paxos, you know, the golden standard for state machine replication, we've observed that majority quorums are not really needed at all. The leader can work with any subset during its tenure, and only the seal command needs to intersect all of these different sets that the leader works with. Again, not majority-like, just intersection. And to underscore, you know, one particular point in the space that this work, which we called flexible Paxos, opens, let's look at the case of an even number of replicas. Okay, so you have n replicas and n is even. And a majority quorum would require, you know, n over 2 plus 1. So a majority, which is more than half of n for each and every command. What flexible Paxos, and then, you know, and then for handling a leader handover, again, more than half, n over 2 over half. What flexible Paxos unlocks for this particular point in the design space is the ability for a leader to work with exactly half of the replicas, not more, and still the leader handover would be exactly half plus one. So there's no trade-off, there's no cost, there's only benefit. And this is actually really important in settings like geodistributed replication. So imagine that you have a service which is deployed over a cluster, half of which is in, let's say, the European continent, and half of which is in the US. Well, under normal replication, that means every time the leader forms agreement on the next command in the sequence, the leader has to cross the Atlantic one way or another. If the leader is in Europe, it has to contact at least one replica in the US or vice versa. And that has been, you know, the source for a lot of geo-replication works that actually elevated and into a hierarchy of distributed transactions over clusters, but never really span across clusters. But really, you know, a lot of these services during the morning in you know, European time zone, they only need to persist and work with servers in Europe, and then later when the sun shines in, you know, the American continent, switch over. There's no reason for them to pay this latency of crossing the Atlantic while they're in steady operation. So this particular point in the curve allows to work on one half of the service, you know, during European work hours, and then switch over to the US when, you know, later in the day, without needing to cross, you know, and pay this latency. And again, without any penalty, any cost, if and when leader needs to be replaced, or if a failure happens and the view needs to change, you still pay exactly n over 2 plus half. So this also indicates that from a foundational point of view, flexible Paxos is a different theoretical foundation for replication than Paxos was. It's strictly stronger. It allows cases that are strictly not allowed before by Paxos. And again, to go back to the flywheel experience of this, so this was really one of my personal favorite stories. Not only you know, a summer intern comes and you know, surprises all of us with an insight that nobody could have predicted. You know, Paxos state machine replication doesn't even need majority quorums for replication. Not only that, what happened after we wrote this is that we've discovered one after another engineered systems in production and engineering teams in the industry that already were building their systems like it. And not only were they building systems like this and they realized this was possible, they tried to go and talk to their local experts, the distributed computing experts, and they were dismissed. Everybody told them, no, Paxos needs majorities. What are you talking about? This is crazy. And did not allow them to post a blog post about the product that have this, you know, terrible flaw or error revealed. And after we've published, they've contacted us and said, hey, you know, thank you. This is we knew this was possible. We just didn't have the foundations to think about it. So this was in retrospect, unknown, but existing systems were already using it. And the flywheel effect is, after publishing it, again, Facebook went on and built out a scale-out messaging pass called LogDevice, which actually utilized flexible Paxos explicitly, knowingly, and they realized that they can really provide performance trade-offs, tuning in production. And I guess the ultimate mark of success is that Werner Vogels, the CTO of Amazon and a well-known leader in distributed computing, tweeted about flexible Paxos. So part of the flywheel effect. So as I said, the takeaway from this, from the third story is the value of unlearning using this quote, the most useful piece of learning is sometimes to unlearn what is untrue. So how am I doing for time? I think I have about 20 minutes left. Is that right, Seth, Fabian, somebody?
Sounds right.
Okay, so fourth and last story. Obviously, I can't go an entire keynote without mentioning my current passion and vision and effort of bringing to the world a new foundation for financial services at Diem. So I'm gonna take a few minutes, like really just a couple of minutes to talk about Diem and then talk about the fourth and last story of the research, industrial research flywheel, which I labeled developer first. But let's talk about what we're trying to achieve in Diem. The existing financial world is lagging behind technology and is failing to serve users all over the world in many ways. An estimated close to 2 billion people are not served by current modern financial system or by any bank and will never be. And even those that are, and by the way, about 30 million of those are in here in the US. So it's not just third world countries or poor nations. Even those that are served by the financial system know that sending money across borders is extremely slow, costly, and a lot of time gets lost. And when private sector companies bring innovation and modern technology to the financial system, they typically do it at the, you know, not at the foundations, not at the house, but, you know, they build the windows or the terrace of the terraces of the financial system. So many services that some of you have in your phones, like PayPal or Venmo or whatever, make it appear like, hey, we actually have digital money at our hands and using, you know, the best phone apps that we can think of, but those are built not at the foundations. So what they build is a system that can bring money into the system. So long as it stays in the system, it can be pretty efficient, but as soon as it needs to be settled and transferred, they have to revert to the existing payment rails in order to settle any transfers. What we're trying to do in Diem is to build new foundations for payments that will be open, instant, low cost, and frictionless. And we'll really reach people anywhere and everyone to be able to access. In a nutshell, we want to bring what the best modern technology can bring to the foundation world, right at the foundation. Now, a lot of this is happening right now by trying to subvert regulation. And that has its pros and cons. What we are trying to do is bring regulators with us. So what we are trying to do is to take central bank money in an arrangement called a stable coin, where users will take fiat, deposit it in a virtual asset service providers or wallets, digital wallets. That money will be kept safely, transparently, and with stability that adheres to banking standards in the bank, and will be tokenized on a payment system which is backed by a blockchain, the Diem blockchain, to allow for movement of these tokenized or digitized money in our system with instant finality, with transparency, and with interoperability for all services. So once a dollar has been put in the reserve and appears on our system, every service on the system can interoperate that way. In order to build these new foundations, these real-time gross settlement platform with openness, with transparency, with immediate finality, reduced fees, and serving all, we need to gain the trust of everybody. We need to gain the trust of regulators. We need to gain the trust of banks, and we need to and financial institutions, and we need to gain the trust of users. And we're doing this by bringing the algorithmic foundations that we know and understand can build a trustworthy service, and by building a framework in a new programming language called Move that encodes the rules of interaction with our platform in a transparent and easily flexibly modifiable manner. And so this ties back to the topic of this keynote. The story of the Byzantine fault tolerance core that drives the Diem blockchain. To start with, I've talked until now about state machine replication, but I mostly used stories and examples from the benign replication world. And to gain, to build a trustworthy service that connects institutions that don't necessarily want to trust any single organization to run it, we bring the foundations of Byzantine replication that actually masks not just benign failures or crashes or inavailability, but even a compromise or a hack or a rogue administrator in any one of these institutions. And when you look at these foundations from the academic front, they've been somewhat lacking. And a lot of innovation was unlocked by the interest of using these foundations for financial services. So before the blockchain arena, Byzantine fault tolerance solutions all had quadratic view replacement mechanism, which is costly when deployed over large networks. There were fairly complex. Only the experts could explain them. So this graph is taken from James Wickham's article, which he titled, I think, "The Saddest Moment in My Career" or something like that. He said, nobody really understands, except the very, very few experts, what goes on under the hood in these Byzantine fault tolerance mechanisms. And several, throughout the history of publications in this field, several algorithms have, in hindsight, been found to have flaws, some of them pretty serious ones. So even the experts find it difficult and complex to construct these Byzantine fault tolerance algorithms. And certainly developers just not wrap their hands around Byzantine fault tolerance. I actually think, the foundations we had with quadratic leader replacement or view change, it's not that complex. So try to write it in one slide, all you have to do is for Byzantine fault tolerance, you need two rounds for leader agreement, not one round. In the first round, you need to collect 2/3 votes, and those are preparing for the commit. And once you have these two rounds, you commit. And a new leader, simply, to make sure that they're consistent with the previous leader, will need to collect you know, from a supermajority reports on whether they voted for any prepare in the past. And because it's a Byzantine leader, you don't trust it. So it will actually need to prove that it's using those two F+1 reports about prepares, and then choose the highest one, and again, go through the two rounds of vote and prepare. That's it. That's the foundations that we had. But they're still quite complex to implement. A lot of variations had flaws. Developers had a really hard time grappling with them. At the same time, something completely unexpected happened, the introduction of Nakamoto consensus, which doesn't use you know, the normal set of replicas. Instead, it used proof of work. It batched commands in a block. So we're now not talking about state machine replication of commands, we're talking about state machine replication of blocks, but that's just semantics, and they're chained. But the real difference is that in order to change these blocks, you don't collect votes, you solve a puzzle, and there are no rounds of voting or anything. There's Nakamoto consensus. These blocks are so difficult to append that you simply pick the longest fork of solved puzzles. And even though, you know, some of these chains may fork for a while, the longest chain will prevail and will be really, really difficult to reproduce or fork. So this is, as you know, probably most people, or if not all on this call, no, this is Nakamoto consensus. And it was quite groundbreaking, but it did have drawbacks to be used as the foundation of a regulated financial infrastructure. Proof of work in itself is very costly and difficult to maintain. This idea of probabilistically correct and takes time to and kind of subjectively finalized is also not something that can be used in the financial setting. And the incentives here to participate correctly is not something that operating a payment service could support. And indeed, even in the cryptocurrency arena, there has been interest to solidify the agreement and decisions, even of Nakamoto consensus. So in a work called Casper from Ethereum, they've introduced what they call the finality gadget, which adds votes on the Nakamoto consensus chain. And these votes are cast by a group of stakeholders, you know, the normal group that of N participants that we would use in the academic setting. And the finality gadget, the Casper finality gadget, when published, worked as follows. So participants, you know, supermajority could cast votes. Each one of these votes could justify a new block based on a previously justified block. And if the previous block was justified and already had 2F+1 votes, then it carries over to the vote, to the 2F+1 vote on the second one. So there is votes that had a source and a target. And once the source is justified, then so does the target. These votes are not collected by a leader. They're simply propagated by gossip. And you get a commit as soon as you have two blocks that are adjacent and succeed one another in the chain in height. Then the source becomes committed. So what the finality gadget provides is over an existing chain that they don't have control over, because this is the Nakamoto consensus chain. It is proposed by, you know, the existing users. There are no votes in these chains. It superimposes votes on these chains in order to determine a commit. In order to make this safe, there are really only two rules. You can only vote once per height, and you cannot vote inside a vote. So you cannot vote for a target if you've already voted for a target between the source and the target that you're voting. So this was shocking. You know, people in the community looked at this and say, this doesn't look at all like anything that we've ever seen. This doesn't look like any algorithm. We don't understand what the heck is going on. So remember, we had PBFT, this was the foundations, and then we had this, you know, this justified votes, and then when it comes on adjacent blocks, then it's committed. What the hell is going on? Well, we looked at it for a long, long time, really long, long time, and we finally realized that it's actually not that different. You get 2F+1 votes on a justified vote. That means this was prepared. And by voting on, you know, this is the source, this is the target, by voting on the target and justifying it with the source, essentially this vote says, this is my highest prepare that I ever voted for, of course, I ever know about. And when you look at the commit rule that requires, you know, adjacent blocks, then what that says is there are two uninterrupted rounds. One is doing the prepare, and the second one is doing the commit, exactly the same way as PBFT. And the main difference is there's no leader that is doing it. The votes are simply propagated, and instead of the leader proving that it uses the right block, voters prove to themselves. They collect votes from everybody, and if they're convinced that this is actually using the right prepare, then they will accept the committee's committing. There's a, but there's a, actually a fairly natural mapping of these rules to PBFT. Like I said, that actually took a long, long time to figure out, but it is there. There's also a lot of other things going on. These blocks are not just voting blocks, they're actually pipelining decisions. So while we're doing all these voting, every single step is already contributing to the sequence. But that's okay. When you commit something, you commit the entire sequence backwards. So it's not like each one of these is a consensus decision. Instead, each one of these is a step in the consensus algorithm. And when you commit something, you commit the prefix before it. And there's a bunch of other things going on. But the most important thing we noticed is that a leader here didn't need to prove anything. Voters were doing it by themselves. And this was puzzling because we knew that leader proving was the most expensive part and the source of quadratic communication in PBFT and in all of the other BFT protocols. And to put this in a table format, ever since, you know, the Byzantine agreement problem was invented, the number of messages to rotate a leader has been at least quadratic. The initial solution is it was actually more complex. They were not intended for practical purposes. They were mostly demonstrating possibility, but ever since practical PBFT was formed, PBFT and follow-on solutions had quadratic number of messages per leader rotation. And here comes Casper, built on completely different foundations, and removes this complexity of proving by the leader that the leader was using the right collection of justifications for the leader proposal. So by analyzing this a little deeper, what happened in Casper and also in similar protocols that were invented in the crypto community is that by doing this, they essentially gave up a fundamental pillar of Byzantine consensus, and that is the ability to make progress when messages are collected from all the correct participants. So all of the practical protocols until it could progress at the network speed. As soon as messages were collected, you can move to the next step and the next step. But Casper was built over Nakamoto consensus. Nakamoto consensus is in any way proposes blocks every 10 minutes. 10 minutes should be enough to collect any messages, even across the internet. So they gave up the ability to move quickly. And if you cast it in you know, standard algorithmic models, it is not an asynchronous protocol. It does not make progress at the speed of the network. So having realized and having mapped this innovative idea that emanated from Casper, we've harnessed this, introduced another step to the protocol, and ended up creating the hot stuff algorithm, which now drives the core of Diem as well. I will very, very quickly zoom through it. So in hot stuff, or in the production version, which is called DMBFT, we are using a permission set, you know, just like the normal academic settings. We are safe against asynchrony and a third of corrupted validators or participants. But we're built with a similar structure as blockchains and Nakamoto consensus, which means a leader can rotate quickly and the leader replacement protocol is very simple. Similar to these protocols, we have a chain of blocks rather than protocol rounds or things that are difficult for the developers to grapple about. And unlike Nakamoto consensus, we build on the solid foundations of, you know, Byzantine fault tolerance algorithms, which means that we have a clear notion and guarantee of finality. We don't rely on energy, costly mechanisms, and we can support low latency and high throughput. I'm not going to really explain hot stuff for DMBFT. I just want to show you in pictures how much it looks like a Nakamoto consensus. So just like blockchain worlds, it's built from the ingredients of blockchains. It has blocks and chains. It does not have protocol rounds. But in order to chain blocks, we use votes or a quorum certificate, which is embedded in these blocks instead of solving a costly puzzle. Blocks are chained one after another as soon as you can collect a quorum of votes on the previous blocks. And if a leader is faulty and you cannot collect a quorum of blocks, then you collect a quorum of timeouts to skip over a leader and chain the new block. And what can happen if it's not clear whether a leader is faulty or not, or if a leader tries to send two different blocks? Well, in order to allow a new leader to propose any extension to the chain, it has to show a timeout certificate, which proves that it is extending the only chain that has collected quorum certificates. And for slightly technical reasons that I will not go into here, you need three chained blocks in order to commit the head of the block. And so finality of an entire prefix of blocks in the chain is achieved as soon as there are three consecutive blocks without a timeout that form quorum certificates. And very much like Nakamoto consensus and the finality gadget, the algorithm is extremely simple to implement. Validators only need to remember two numbers, the last round that they voted in. They're only allowed to vote in one round, and the highest round, which they saw a quorum certificate for, and this is what they justify to the leader when they vote. Takeaways and kind of wrapping back to the flywheel. Introducing, you know, so the first thing I want to say is that the blockchain arena and this new use case of state machine replication unlocked tremendous innovation. We were taking a tip of it and extending it. Specifically with respect to hot stuff, what made it suitable to gain your trust and, you know, the user community's trust is, First of all, it is, you know, an algorithm that embodies and incorporates four decades of advances, rigorous guarantees and advances in the field. But secondly, it took all of them, combined them with the insight that came from the developer community itself, and was made popular because it can be understood by developers. And not just understood, and I'm not condescending developers here. If you need to maintain a production system with generations and generations of engineers that come and maintain it, it needs to be simple enough so that when you keep growing and evolving it, you won't break it. As of this date, Hotstuff drives the core of Diem, as well as several other blockchains that we know of, like Flow, the Dapper Labs blockchain, Celo, Ethereum, and potentially others. So that's it. I hope these stories were insightful. I think that the flywheel takeaways from all of these stories has been, you know, for me, fascinating. And I want to thank you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Dahlia. Are there any questions?
May I ask something, Seth?
Please.
Hey, Dahlia, it was an excellent talk. Thank you.
Thank you. This is Chris's talking, yes.
Yeah, this is Chris's, yes. How are you doing?
Good, thanks.
Two questions. One is technical, the other is like more conceptual. So how long it takes for a block in to get in DM and PFT? On average, have you made some measures about this?
We do. So right now in deployment in our, you know, geo-distributed, diversified testnet, which is public. We are finalizing or committing blocks in typically less than a second, and in almost all cases, less than 5 seconds. And we'll be releasing, and everything of course is open and open source, so you can deploy and test it yourself. In the coming release, which will be 1.5, we're actually cutting down 30% of that. So,
wow. Okay.
This is per block, not per command, of course.
Yeah, correct. Okay, so the other one is more concerned about the community. So I was puzzled by what you said before that the engineers have been doing some things that we end up discovering later from a more theoretical aspect. So from your experience, and because you had maybe the unique fortune to be involved both in academia and in industry, how would the community be able to reach the industry and maybe try to grasp some of these problems and bring them to us? Since what I also understood what you said is that the engineers were trying to convince us, but they didn't have the skills to do so. But our community has the skills to tackle these problems and give them a more formal treatment and make them more solid and more foundational. So given all these years of experience of your involvement, how you advise our community to reach out into these people and try to see how we can do this two-way transfer, as you said in the beginning?
Yeah, thanks for the question. Obviously, I tried to talk for an hour, and I can talk for many, many more hours just addressing this question. I think hopefully I gave a balanced story of it's not all bad. You know, Flexible Access was a staggering case that really surprised all of us in all respects. You know, we didn't see it, the fact that people didn't listen, but there are also, you know, really, really good takeaways. It's not bad. You know, I think the synergy for the most part is fruitful and works well. What can we do better in the community? Look, I don't have a recipe. I don't want to say that we are hiring at Novi Research. So if you want to just come work with us close to production, let me know, and anybody else in the audience. I don't have a recipe. I think that this particular community Disk, Podsy, whatever, distributed community, has over the years drifted somewhat away from systems. And a lot of the distributed systems / computing relevant work has migrated to other conferences. And that's a shame. I wish this community goes back and remains more relevant and leading the field. And with respect to how to do it, I think work with the industry, come give talks and listen to the questions that engineers are asking. And maybe more, I mean, I can offer a lot of ideas, but no panacea solution. I think maybe more joint conferences with some of the systems conferences, more joint events. Yeah.
Thank you. I know it's a tough question and we don't have good answers, but we have to do something about it. That's the thing. Thank you, Dalia.
Thanks. Looks like Shai has his hand up.
Hi, I enjoyed this also.
Thank you.
Just a minor technical point I missed. When you're doing, I mean, it's a major technical point, but in your subject, I'm not asking about how to do technology transfer. When you're talking about voting, don't you have to assume that you know who are the voters or how many of them are there? Or if you're talking about 2F, I did not understand, where do you take F from when we are talking about the financial world, right? We want to withstand any number.
Yes, so obviously I went extremely fast and glossed over a lot of details, apologies. Specifically when you talk about whether it's hot stuff, whether it's the deployed DMBFT in DM, and whether you talk about some of the other systems, there are fundamentally two ways in which these deployments work. Either there is indeed a known set of, we call them validators or nodes or participants, but validators is the technical term typically used. At DM, these validator nodes are operated by known, admitted, permitted participants. Some of the other chains,
like banks, or
well, I don't like specifically, you know, to say banks, but they are at DM. They are members of our consortium of the DM Association. So we have 27 as of today, 27 member companies. Each one of them operate a validator node. In other settings, there are different mechanisms. Some of them are permissioned, like ours. You actually know who are the permitted participants. Different mechanisms do it by stake. So some networks allow value holders to commit to a certain value of their operation, so that if they are found to behave incorrectly or wrongly, that stake is forfeited. And your participation and your voting is weighted based on how much value you stake. So that's another model. All of these abstractly do translate into the N participants and, you know, majorities and so forth. And this is separate. So the deployment is separate from, you know, what is the algorithmic core. Once you get to the algorithmic core, all of the deployment is abstracted and you're dealing with N entities, as in the traditional setting. And remember, I started with mapping Nakamoto consensus, which doesn't have that, and then the finality gadget, which said, okay, well, Nakamoto consensus has a lot of advantages, but it doesn't have finality in the traditional sense. And so Casper introduced this notion of, okay, let's have a set of N entities that are kind of like oracles that vote on the finality.
replying for another question?
So, yeah, go ahead.
Yeah. So I was wondering about the first part of the talk related to state machine replication. You said that traditional systems implemented agreement in sequence one by one. And then later you also mentioned that the existing systems already did flexible paxos. And I wonder if you can name them just, you know, out of curiosity. You know, just maybe give references to them because, you know, maybe something to teach my students in the course or something.
Sure. So you should know that out of all of this audience, the one question I'm most scared of is Edith's question. I know she was going to ask me a hard one. So let's start with this notion of vertical paxos or log-based replication. I think I actually mentioned as I was going along, systems that independently employed this notion of log prefix replication.
Yeah, rather than ones that fixed it, right? But you mentioned the ones that fixed it, Zookeeper and
Right.
Zookeeper and Graft fixed the prefix thing. But right. Which were the ones that did it one by one?
Maybe. Oh, pretty much every, I don't have names, but pretty much okay. Every system we looked at Microsoft, okay. We had, there was a replication library that was used across all the system, and they all operated one by one, every single system. And when we talked to Google engineers, they said this exactly the same thing.
Really?
And if you actually, okay. Yes. And if you actually look at Chubby, if you actually look at Chubby at the internals, at least early versions, by one.
Okay.
And then when I talked about flexible paxos, I think the slide shows that YouTube had a cluster of SQL servers on top of a replication engine, which actually implemented flexible paxos and realized that they were doing it, but they couldn't convince the algorithmic experts that there's something there.
Well, great talk. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks. So if there are no other questions, I will thank you again for coming to this crazy non-academic talk, and I'll go back to try to change the world.
Hey, thank you. Thank you again for your talk, and good luck.
Thank you.
Thank you.